I've often wondered what the time from Good Friday afternoon to Easter Sunday at dawn must have been like for the apostles. They had been the special privileged friends of the Master. Now they were nothing more than followers of a convicted criminal. We know they were in hiding, afraid the Jesus fate might become theirs too. And then the rumor started. Someone has seen the Lord. He is alive. But it seems that each one had to see for themselves. The men wouldn't believe the women, and Thomas wouldn't believe anyone. The only way he would believe was if he could touch Jesus' wounds so he could be absolutely certain that this was the same man he saw pierced through with nails and sword. Thomas wasn't looking for faith, but for certainty. When there's no room for doubt, there's no need for faith. When Thomas finally sees Jesus and proclaims, "My Lord and my God," Jesus asks him, "Have you believed because you have seen me?" Well, Thomas, the truly blessed ones are those who have not seen and yet come to believe. And so it is, we have the faith that Thomas lacked. Not that we never doubt, not that there isn't something of Thomas in each of us, but in the long haul, we are believers. And indeed, we are blessed. In the early church, this question of faith was a hot issue indeed. And just as the early Christians struggled to understand the Easter event, so do we. And so do those who were baptized or confirmed at the Easter Vigil. They now begin a 50-day period of reflection on the Easter mystery. For all of us, then, Easter is not over, it has just begun. This period between Easter and Pentecost even has a special name. It's called the Great Sunday. For 50 days, we have Easter celebrations as if every day were Easter Sunday again. And in this time, we study this incredible Paschal mystery. Throughout the Great Sunday this year, the second reading is taken from the book of Revelation. This is not an easy book to understand, especially in light of the fact that those religions who read scripture literally have used it to prove such things as how many will get to heaven and when the end of the world will come. To explain each segment in a short homily would be difficult. Therefore, each Sunday, you will find an explanation of the day's passage in the bulletin. We hope this will be helpful in uncovering some of the mystery surrounding its content. Today's first reading is not difficult to understand. It tells us what life was like for the believers immediately after the first Easter. Luke describes the life of these early Christians in such glowing terms that some scholars think it's not to be taken too literally. Were they indeed so united that they all gave up their private possessions and shared everything in common? Did they really sell their land and houses and lay the proceeds at the apostles' feet for distribution to the needy? Was this the way they lived, or was Luke simply describing the ideal Christian life? It would seem that Luke wasn't exaggerating, at least according to one non-Christian witness. These are the words of Aristides, a pagan who defended the Christians before the Emperor Hadrian in these words. Christians love one another. They never fail to help widows. They save orphans from those who would hurt them. And if someone has something, he gives freely to the one who has nothing. If they see a stranger, Christians take him into their homes and treat him as a brother. Not that they consider themselves brothers and sisters in the usual sense, but brothers and sisters instead through the Spirit, in God. And if they hear that one of them is in jail or persecuted for professing the name of their Redeemer, they all give him what he needs. If it is possible, they bail him out. If one of them is poor and there isn't enough food to go around, they fast several days to give him the food he needs. We are dealing here, Aristides concludes, with a new kind of person. There is something divine in them. Quite a testimony from a pagan. But there's another reason to believe Luke's description of the early Christians. Apparently, it was their radically different lifestyle that contributed to the phenomenal growth of this little band of believers. Simply preaching the resurrection would not have convinced many. But when believers become part of a community built on justice, compassion, sharing all things in love, where each one willingly contributes to the needs of the community, people take notice. At the end of this liturgy, St. Joseph's Parish is going to ask each of us to consider how we can contribute to the needs of our community, specifically by sharing our parish's financial burdens. This isn't a subject we have spoken of often in this parish, but the fact of rising costs is a fact of parish life. The reality is that we are in very real need of the help of each of you. Whether you are a regular attendee or one of the many who come here from time to time for spiritual refreshment, we hope that you will all be inspired to share in the charism of the early church. Indeed, the love displayed by the early church is a hard act to follow. But in today's gospel, Jesus missions and empowers us to do just that. Today he says to us, "Peace be with you. Trust in my unfailing love for you, and receive my Holy Spirit, the Spirit who empowers you to live lovingly in my name. And now, as the Father has sent me, so am I sending you." As believers in the risen Lord, we are sent to be witnesses of the love of God to the rest of the world. As Luke and Aristides have shown us, the best way to witness to this love is by loving in turn, by being stewards of that love, sharing ourselves and what we have with one another to the glory of God. Maybe someday people will point to us, the members of St. Joseph's Parish, and say, "We are dealing here with a new kind of person. There is something divine in them."